Hello and welcome to Trojans Live.
We didn't know. We thought we were playing Washington. Now we're playing Oregon. That's why Coach Clay Helton's joining us straight off the practice field.
Yeah, hey, guys, how we doing?
Oh, there he is. All right. You're good.
We just left the practice field.
All right. We appreciate any time. We were just talking about how busy your week is and with signing day and the game coming up a day early on Friday. Does it help at least that you know who your opponent is now?
It does help. You know, obviously it's a short week and we were in preparing for Washington and, you know, flipped the switch about lunchtime today. And so we were able to get a late afternoon practice in, be able to install some couple thoughts for Oregon and be able to intro them. And now we'll get a full practice tomorrow and work towards Oregon for Friday night.
Coach, just an amazing ball game. We witnessed the other night watching you beat the Bruins and kind of rip their heart out at the end of the game. I talked to you after the game, got to ask you a question about the fight of this team. When you think about it and when you had a little chance to digest it, what does it mean? You've had three games now where it's just your team has not given up, has not let go. The want to win these ball games has been tremendous. How proud are you of these guys and their ability and the identity really of this team is to fight and to not give up?
Yeah, you know, they've done it all year, Sean, to be honest with you. I mean, all of 2020 has been about dealing with adversity, being tough, being disciplined, staying together. In each and every game, this team gets hardened even more, comes together even more. It's been so fun to coach them because, you know, each and every game I just watch them love each other, play for each other, and that's what great teams do. You know, and when the moments have been most critical, they just step up to the plate and get the job done. You know, I felt so confident, you know, even calling the timeout after third down when UCLA had the ball, knew they were going to kick a field goal, and looked up and there was a minute two left on the clock. I said, we got this. This is going to be good. We've got enough time to be. We got a big stop there and it allowed us to have enough time to drive it right back down and take the leading score.
You know, I mentioned this on the broadcast, but it was my first time all season as a sideline reporter actually being near the sideline. I got to be sort of, you know, behind you guys, but at least close enough to really feel the emotions of the game. And, you know, I got a sense of how much of the emotion you guys have to generate yourself this season. We talked about that. I still don't think fans get it because you have to experience it to get it. And I'm just wondering at halftime, how much the adjustments were emotional, like, hey, guys, we got to get the juice going in this game again. This is getting away from us. Or how much was, you know, scheme where you said, okay, there's some run fits here and there's some things that we're getting beat on that we need to fix?
Yeah, it was really twofold, to be honest with you, Jordan. It was one, I thought Chip did a wonderful job coming out. Anytime you play Coach Kelly, you know you're going to get some unbalanced set that maybe you haven't seen, some option play you haven't seen. He's extremely creative in each and every game. He makes you make adjustments. And so when we came in at halftime, we said, guys, we just took their best shot. They played as good as you could play, and we didn't play our best ball. Plus, our emotion can go up. We've lived and thrived off each other and really have fed off each other, and that wasn't our brand of ball in the first half. And I can promise you, if you take from play one of the second half and you go play our brand of ball with great emotion, great discipline, doing what we're supposed to do, you're going to look up in the fourth quarter and you're going to be right back in the game. And then the most important thing I thought in telling them was you had to go win the fourth. You know, UCLA had been a great fourth quarter team up until that game. I mean, you go back, I think it was like 31 points to 3 they had been in the games prior. And then we finished off that game scoring 20 in the fourth quarter to their 3. And that was the difference. Our kids did a tremendous job of fighting on and winning that fourth quarter and ultimately winning the game.
Coach, defensively, you know, slow start. I thought a lot of it was brought on by some bad tackling, but you guys finished strong. You come out there, you get two fourth down stops. You get an interception by Talanoa. You know, you talked about it. Coach Kelly coming unbalanced. I saw some three tight end, you know, sets, pulling four guys at times. Just some wild things going on there on offense. What was the difference, the adjustments made specifically in the second half of the defense that helped them, you know, make those key stops at the end of the game?
Yeah, you know, it was one, being able to handle the tempo, and we had seen the looks and we were able to draw them up and say, okay, hey guys, they are going unbalanced. Hey, they are doing some tackle over. Hey, they are going formation in the boundary. They are going with speed. So you got to get your eyes back and get the call quick and get lined up. This is what they're doing. And our kids adjusted to it. It wasn't necessarily calls or scheme, because even in the first half, the kids were in position to make plays. We didn't make our plays. You know, we let some balls through, like you said, on some missed tackles. And I thought they came out in the second half, played cleaner football, more confident football. They knew what was going on. And then all of a sudden you saw those drives being stopped, and it allowed our offense to catch up.
You know, Coach, I'm sort of going to combine two questions and two themes here. Watching that game, you know, there are some plays that guys like Tyler Vaughns and Drake London and Amon Ross St. Brown and Talanoa Hufanga and Drake Jackson make, and others too. But, those guys in that game, you can't really coach. I mean, you won that battle on National Signing Day a year ago or 3 years ago or 5 years ago, whatever it is. And so, you know, I bring you to Wednesday and the importance of winning those battles. I mean, it just plays out that way, because what Tyler Vaughns did in double coverage, I mean, I don't care how many drills you run, you can't simulate it. I mean, it's just incredible. Drake London's catch and run, it's just ridiculous. It brings me to Wednesday and how important of a day that is for your program to just keep funneling in elite talent that can make plays when the game is on the line.
Yeah, definitely. You have to, you know, signing day is an important day because you bring new members into your family and talent into your family. And obviously coaches are nice, but players are so much better. You know, I'm a lot better coach when Adoree Jackson's here and Juju Smith-Schuster and Drake London and Amon Ross St. Brown. And, you know, we've signed these kids and we're going to sign more based on our evaluation. And some of them are going to be extremely highly ranked based on services. And some of them we feel that are five stars for us, that they may be lower ranked, but we know they're Trojans. And, you know, I'll never forget, like you mentioned a name, like the name Drake London, being able to watch him in high school and knowing how special he's going to be, and really didn't care what anybody had him ranked, you know. And then you're going to have the Amon Ross St. Browns that the whole world knows. But the guys that we bring in here on Wednesday are extremely important, because they bring talent and they bring the ability to help us win championships. So Wednesday is an important day. It just happens to be on championship week, which is the first time in my 26 years of coaching. So it makes for some long nights. At least we know who we're playing now, and we'll recruit and coach as hard as we can over the next 48 hours.
Coach, you speak of it, having to adjust on the fly here. You're just getting off the practice field. Not a normal day for you. You wake up thinking you're playing Washington. A lot of stuff transpires, and now you're playing Oregon. When you see the Ducks play, what can we expect to see out there offensively, defensively? What are you looking for from the Ducks?
Yeah, Mario's done a nice job of recruiting himself, and he's got several good athletes, especially offensively. You know, you look at that offense and you see the running backs, the wide outs, and how much speed is on the field. And then, you know, we know Tyler Show and know that what he's able to do. He can get streaky hot, and when he does, he's a really, really talented player. So, you know, hopefully we can do our job and get them in, you know, some behind the chains a little bit, and hopefully try to force Tyler off his spot. Defensively, they give a variety of looks. They bounce in and out of four down and then odd structure. They bring pressures from everywhere, movement from everywhere, disguise coverages extremely well. It'll be a good challenge for us offensively. These are two good teams competing against each other, and that's the way it should be in a championship game. And obviously Mario has done a nice job in getting here. So we look forward to competing against them.
Well, it's a great week, Coach, as long as you hate sleep. So we're going to let you go work, go sign a top 10 signing class, go win a Pac-12 championship. We'll talk to you next week.